Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Today we will continue our topic on chapter 4, that is over eight lines and its mechanical characteristics. So basically the contents of the topics, introduction, main component of overhead lines, conductor material, line supports, insulators, corona, sag, and also mechanical properties. Okay, basically, as introduction, we would like to know that electrical power can be transmitted either by means of underground cable or overhead lines. And the underground cable are rarely used for power transmission due to power is generally transmitted over long distance to load center. So this will generate very high cost for installation. And secondly, electrical power has to be transmitted at high voltage for economic reason. So because of that, very difficult to provide proper insulation to the cable to withstand the high voltage. Because of that, as a rule, power transmission over long distance is carried out using overhead lines. So let's see the main component of overhead line. So basically, the component of overhead line consists of the conductor, okay, line support, insulator, cross arm, and also miscellaneous items such as lightning arrester, phase plates, danger plates, anti-climbing wire, and also etc. So this is the example of the tower. Okay, we can see that overhead transmission line tower consists of the tower top, okay, and also tower body as well as the tower base. So in the tower top, there is overhead ground wire, beam, okay, cross arm, tower window, fork, that is K-frame, conductor bundle, and also the insulator string. Okay, this is insulator string. While in tower body, there is a waist, okay, diagonal, the main leg, and the horizontal member. Okay, in the tower base, there is a, we can say the concrete or the beam, okay, for the tower to withstand. And this figure show the cross arm of the transmission tower, and also the tower body. Now let's see the conductor materials. So basically, conductor material must be high electrical conductivity, high tensile strength to withstand mechanical stress, low cost so that it can be used for long distances, and low specific gravity so that weight per unit volume is small. Okay, most commonly used conductor material for overhead line are copper, okay, aluminium, steel core aluminium, galvanized steel, and also the cadmium copper. So we will see the detail of all this conductor material on the next slide. So first, copper, an ideal material for overhead line owing to its high electrical conductivity and greater tensile strength, okay. It has higher current density, which means it can, the current carrying capacity is quite large. Okay, so the other advantage is smaller as X sectional area of conductor is required. So only small conductor is required. The area offered by the conductor to wind load is reduced. Okay, moreover, this metal is quite homogeneous, durable, and has high scrap value. But because of that, the disadvantage is nothing but high cost. Second is aluminium. Aluminium is cheaper than conductor and also light, okay, compared to copper, but it has small conductivity and small tensile strength. Okay, relative comparison between these two material, between aluminium and copper, are the conductivity of aluminium is 60% that of copper, okay. The X section area of conductor must be larger than in copper. This means that accession area of aluminium is larger. For the same resistance, the diameter of aluminium conductor is about 1.26 times the diameter of copper conductor. So the increased accession of aluminium exposes a greater surface to wind pressure. Therefore, supporting tower must be designed for greater strength. So because of accession is high, okay, and also the diameter is high, so we need to design a tower which is higher, greater strength compared if we use the copper. This often requires the use of higher towers with consequence or greater sag. The specific gravity of aluminium is 2.71 gram per cc, lower than copper, which is 8.9 gram per cc. Okay, and aluminium has almost one half the weight of equivalent copper conductor. Weight is okay, weight is less, okay, compared to copper. For this reason, the supporting structure of aluminium need to be made so strong as copper conductor. Being light, okay, because of aluminium is light, is liable to greater swing and larger hands. Greater swing and larger, hence cross arm is are required. Okay. So because light, so it can be the swing will be very great, high swing. Okay, easy to swing compared to the copper. So hand cross arm are required. And larger cross arm are required. Due to lower tensile strength and higher coefficient of linear expansion of aluminium, the sag is greater in aluminium conductor. Okay, we will see the detail on the sag later at the end of the chapter. Considering the combined properties of coarse, conductivity, tensile strength, weight, and etc., aluminium has an edge over copper. Therefore, it is widely used as a conductor material. Now we see the steel core aluminium. Okay, due to low tensile strength, strength is low, aluminium conductor produce greater sag. Sag ni, the meaning of sag is more or less kendur. Kendur. Sebenarnya dia kendur. Okay, this prohibit they are used for larger span and make them unsuitable for long distance transmission. So in order to increase the tensile strength, okay, to increase the tensile strength, aluminium conductor is reinforced with a core of galvanized steel wire. Okay, we can see from this figure, in the middle is the steel, okay, galvanized steel wire. This is the galvanized steel wire, but the aluminium is surrounded by the steel. Okay. The composite conductor is known as steel cored aluminium and is abbreviated as ACSR. Okay, this is just for your knowledge. Steel cored aluminium conductor consists of central core of galvanized steel wire surrounded by a number of aluminium strand. Okay, we have seen this figure before. Usually the diameter of both steel aluminium wire is same. Okay, the diameter also the same. And the advantage of steel cored aluminium, okay, first the reinforcement with steel increase the tensile strength. Okay, so which means that the strength is increased, but at the same time keep the composite conductor light. Okay, therefore steel cord aluminium conductor will produce smaller sag and hence longer span can be used. Okay, due to small sag with steel cord aluminium conductor, tower of smaller height can also be used. Now we see the galvanized steel. Steel has very high tensile strength, which is good, okay, steel. But galvanized steel conductor can be used for assembly long spans or for short line section exposed to abnormally high stresses due to climatic condition and also suitable in rural area where cheapness is the main consideration. Of course, steel is cheaper than aluminium and copper. It is not suitable for transmitting large power over a long distance due to poor conductivity. Okay, steel has poor conductivity and also high resistance. Now let's see the cadmium steel. The copper conductor is alloyed with cadmium. Okay, copper conductor is alloyed with cadmium. In addition, 1% and 2% cadmium to copper. Okay, increase the tensile strength by 50%. Just add 1% and 2% cadmium will increase the tensile strength by 50%, but conductivity reduced only by 15%. And also it is useful for exceptionally long spans. However, due to high cost of cadmium, this conductor will be economically only for lines of small X section. That is where the cost of conductor material is comparatively small compared with the cost of the supports. Now let's see the line support. Line support is a supporting structure for overhead line conductors such as poles and tower. In general, the line support should have the following properties. First, high mechanical stress to withstand the weight of conductor and wind loads. Second, light in weight without loss of mechanical strength. Third, cheap in cost and economically to maintain. Fourth, longer life. And fifth, easy accessibility of conductor for maintenance. Okay, there are four types of line support. That is wooden pole, steel pole, reinforced concrete pole, and lattice steel tower. Okay, the choice of supporting structure for a particular case depend upon the lifespan, exceptional area, land voltage, cost, and the local condition. Now we look at the case of wooden pole. Basically wooden, so all the pole structure is made by the wood, and we can see the comparison between double pole structure of A type and also double pole structure of H type. Okay, and then we will see the wooden pole made of seasoned wood and suitable for lines for moderate accession area and relatively shorter span up to 50 meter. Cheap, easily available, providing insulating properties, and widely used for distribution purpose in rural area as an economical proposition. Generally tend to rot below the ground level, causing foundation failure. Because wood, okay, wood is not longer lasting, okay. Dalam bahasa Melayunya dia senang rosak, kena makan dengan anak-anak dan sebagainya. So, jadi dia boleh mudah untuk terbenam, tenggelam ke dalam tanah, yang akan menyebabkan foundation failure. So wooden pole juga ada disadvantage, tendency to rot below the ground level. So smaller life span dia 25 tahun saja. Cannot be used for voltage higher than 20 kV. Okay, less mechanical strength and require periodical inspection. Kena buat dia punya inspection banyak kali untuk pastikan keadaan kayu dia sama ada rosak ataupun masih lagi okey. Kemudian steel pole. Steel pole guna steel, okey. Often used as a substitute of wooden pole, have greater mechanical strength, longer life and permit longer span to use. Generally used for distribution purpose in the cities, need to be galvanized and painted in order to prolong its life. Okey. Kena letak ni lah supaya dia elakkan dia daripada karat. Okey. Kemudian reinforced concrete pole. Tadi kita ada wood, kita ada apa? Steel dan kita ada concrete. Yang ketiga concrete very popular as line support in recent year. Okay, have greater mechanical strength, longer life and permit longer span than steel pole. Give good outlook. Nampak cantik lah. Require little maintenance and have good insulating properties. Okay. The main difficulty is the high cost of transport owing to their heavy weight. Berat. Concrete ni sangat berat dan susah nak buat kan? Pakai lang. Therefore, such pole often manufactured at the site. Biasanya dibuat dekat site lah. Pasang ni buat kat site terus, terus pasang to avoid heavy cost of transportation. Okay, ini contoh reinforced concrete pole ataupun RCC. So bagi dua keadaan yang berbeza lah, satu 7.5 meter tinggi dan satu lagi 10 meter. Okay. Alright. Kemudian lattice steel tower. Lattice steel tower in practice, wooden, steel and reinforced concrete pole are used for distribution purpose at low voltage up to 11 kV saja. Manakala for long distance transmission at higher voltage, steel tower are used. Kita tengok banyak kat negara kita, kat Malaysia ke, Indonesia ke, kat negara lain, banyak gunakan steel tower untuk yang high voltage, higher than 11 kV. And then they have great mechanical strength, longer life, can withstand most severe climatic condition and permit the use of longer spans. The risk of interrupted service due to broken insulation is considerably reduced owing to their longer span. Okay, this is contoh of the lattice steel tower. Ada dua bahagian. Yang pertama untuk 110 kV, case span 320 meter, and then 220 kV, span 320 meter. Okay. Tower footing are usually grounded by driving rods into the earth. Okay, footing dia ni masuk dalam tanah. Okay, footing ni masuk dalam tanah. Minimize the lightning trouble as each tower act as a lightning conductor. So, bila ada kilat, so tower ni sebab dia steel, so dia akan bertindak sebagai konduktor bawa kilat tu ke dalam bumi, ke dalam tanah. Ini contoh-contoh yang lain. Okay, bagi lattice steel tower. Kemudian cross arm. Cross arm ni tujuan dia untuk hold the insulator and conductor. Okay. Dua-dua. Ni cross arm. So, kat dalam cross arm ni dia ada insulator dan juga dia ada conductor lah. Conductor. So, So boleh tengok ni cross arm yang ni ialah tower body. Dalam case yang gambar yang ni, cross arm is this part. Okay. And this is the cross arm, sorry. This is insulator. Okay. Dan juga ini adalah dia punya conductor eh. Ini conductor dia. Okay. Conductor. Now, kita tengok pada insulator. Insulator, function dia adalah untuk insulate lah. Okay. The overhead line conductor should be supported on the poles or tower in such a way that the current from conductor do not flow to earth through tower pole. Okay, kita ada tower, kemudian kita ada cross arm. So, jadi conductor yang nak bawa current tu, kan dia mesti ada protection dia, iaitu gunakan insulator supaya current from the conductor tidak flow kepada tower. Okay, ataupun flow kepada cross arm tersebut. Okay, this is achieved by securing the line conductor to support with the help of insulator. Okay. Okay, the insulator provide necessary insulation between line conductor and tower pole to prevent any leakage current from conductor to the earth. Okay, this is the example of the insulator. Let's say this is the overhead line or the conductor. So this is the cross arm. So insulator will protect the current flow from conductor to the cross arm or to the tower. Okay. Properties of insulator must be high mechanical strength in order to withstand conductor load, wind load and etc. Okay. High electrical resistance of insulator material in order to avoid leakage current. Okay. We have discussed this previously, to avoid leakage current to the earth. Eh? High relative permeability to of insulator material in order that the electric strength is high. The insulator material should be non-porous, free from impurities and cracks. Otherwise, the permeability is low. And the most commonly used material for insulator overhead line is porcelain glass. Okay, porcelain but glass. Porcelain with glass. Eh? Steatite and special composition material are also used to a limited extent. Why porcelain? Because porcelain is stronger mechanically than glass. Okay, give less trouble from leakage current and is less affected by changes of the temperature. Okay, now we see at the type of insulator, there is four type of insulator, that is spin type insulator, suspension type insulator, strain type insulator, and also shackle insulator. Okay, let's see the pin type insulator. There is a groove on the upper end of the insulator for housing the conductor. Okay, groove of the upper end of the insulator. And used for transmission and distribution of electric power at voltage up to 33 kV only. Okay, beyond 33 kV, it becomes too bulky and hence uneconomical. Okay, let's see the picture of the pin type insulator. Bentuk pun, dia pun dah memang macam pin. So, ini namakan pin type insulator eh. Dan digunakan up to 33 kV only. A second suspension type insulator for high voltage over 33 kV. It is usually in practice to use suspension type insulator. Okay. They consist of a number of porcelain discs. Okay, banyak porcelain discs connected in series by metallic in the form of a string. Okay, kita tengok ni gambar dia. Suspension type insulator ni. Kan, okay. Okay, setiap satu insulator ni ada satu disc. Ada disc eh. Ha, kalau macam ni ada banyak lah disc dia. Okay. Ini contoh yang lebih mudah. Kita tengok kat sini ada 3 disc. Okay, disc 1, disc 2 dan disc 3 daripada porcelain. Okay. Yang ni bawah ni line conductor. Okay, yang atas ni dia punya cross arm. Dia sangkut pada cross arm. Okay, the conductor is suspended at the bottom end of the string while other end is secure to the cross arm of the tower. Okay, dah cakap sebelum ni. The number of disc in series would obviously depend upon the working voltage. Depend on working voltage. Okay. Each unit of this is designed follow voltage. Setiap satu disc tu, setiap satu porcelain tu, voltage dia adalah 11 kV only. So, if the working voltage is 660 kV, then 6 discs will be provided on the string. So, kalau contoh ni ada 4. 4, so maknanya 44 lah. 44 kV eh. Advantage of suspension type insulator. Okay. Yang pertama dia murah. Compare pin tab insulator. Okay, for voltage over 33 kV. Second, each unit or disc of suspension type is designed for low voltage. Usually 11 kV, kita dah bincang sebelum ni. Depending on the working voltage, the desired number of discs can be connected in series. And then if only one disc is damaged, okay, the whole string does not become useless because the damaged disc can be replaced. Sebab dia stack of disc, so kita boleh tukar mana disc yang rosak. The suspension arrangement provide greater flexibility to the line. Yang ketiga, strand insulator. Strand insulator ni biasanya digunakan dead end of the line, pada hujung line, ataupun there is a corner or sharp curve, okay, where the line is subjected to greater tension. Okay, nak memerlukan tension atau tegangan yang tinggi. So kita akan sambungkan strand insulator biasanya pada hujung lah, hujung transmission line, okay, disambung dengan strand insulator. Okay, boleh tengok dalam dua-dua gambar ni. Okay. Kemudian shackle insulator, okay, they are used for LV, okay, low voltage distribution line, okay, low voltage saja. Okay, can be used either in horizontal position or in vertical position, dan boleh dipasang directly to the pole with bolt or to the cross arm. Okay, ni ada pole, contoh dalam ni ada pole, so boleh dia pasang sekali dengan bolt ataupun terus pasang pada pole tersebut. Okay, ini jenis-jenis insulator, gambar-gambar. Okay, you can look and see at the type of insulator. Potential distribution over suspension insulator string. Okay, kita lihat daripada gambar ni. Okay, untuk apa nama suspension insulator, sebab dia ada apa disc yang disusun in stack. So jadi katalah contohnya ada tiga disc. Okay, disc A, disc yang pertama, disc yang kedua dan disc yang ketiga. So bawah dia conductor, okay, atas dia adalah tower ataupun cross arm ni. So voltage, total voltage daripada tower ke conductor, dia, kita namakan dia sebagai V. So setiap disc tu ada voltage masing-masing, V1, V2 dan juga V3. Okay, untuk tiga bahagian. V3 yang paling dekat dengan conductor, so V3 should be higher lah compared to V2 and compared to V1, sebab dia paling dekat dengan conductor. Okay, dalam bentuk circuit, so kita boleh convertkan disc ni ke dalam bentuk capacitor. Okay, capacitor C, C dan juga C untuk tiga bahagian. So voltage pada ketika itu ialah voltage bagi tiga, V bagi tiga, V bagi tiga dan juga V bagi tiga. Okay, dalam pada masa yang sama juga ada shunt capacitor. Shunt capacitor kat sini, okay, yang terjadi di antara apa nama insulator tu, okay, suspension insulator dengan tower ataupun dia punya cross arm ni lah. Okay, so kalau ada tiga disc, so ada tiga shunt capacitor pada gambar rajah ni. Okay, ini penerangan dia. The position, portion of each disc is in between two metal link. Each disc form a capacitor C as shown in previous figure. So, saya terangkan tadi. This is known as mutual capacitance or self-capacitance. Okay. Kemudian, if there were mutual capacitance alone, the charging current would have been the same through all the discs and consequently voltage across each unit would be the same. That is voltage bagi dengan tiga. In actual practice, capacitance also exists between metal fitting of each disc and tower or earth. Okay, this is known as shunt capacitance. Yang tadi adalah mutual capacitance ataupun self capacitance. Okay, yang kedua adalah shunt capacitance. So ada dua. Kalau kita rujuk gambar yang tadi sebelum ni, so yang ni adalah mutual capacitance. Okay, yang bagian ni adalah shunt capacitance. Okay, due to shunt capacitance, charging current is not the same through all the discs of the string. Current dia adalah berbeza-beza. Therefore, voltage across each disc will be different. Okay, saya dah terangkan tadi, the disc nearest to the line conductor, disc nearest to the line conductor will have maximum voltage because charging current through the string has the maximum value at the disc nearest to the conductor. Okay, refer to figure 3. V3 will be much more than V2 or V1. Okay, all right. And then some points that may be noted regarding the potential distribution over a string. Pertama sekali, voltage on a string of suspension insulator does not distribute uniformly, okay, across the individual disc due to the presence of shunt capacitance. Okay, ada shunt capacitance, so dia punya voltage tak distribute uniformly. Kemudian, the disc nearest to the conductor has maximum voltage across it. Disc nearest the conductor, okay, has maximum voltage across it. Paling dekat dengan conductor, paling tinggi dia punya voltage. As we move toward the cross arm, okay, daripada bawah, okay, kalau katakanlah ni conductor, kemudian naik ke atas, okay, kita ada tiga tadi C, ada tiga disc, C, C dan C. So, jadi voltage yang bawah ni paling rendah, kemudian, voltage bawah paling tinggi, kemudian naik, dia makin, voltage dia makin berkurang. Eh? Okay, the unit nearest to the conductor is under maximum electrical stress and is likely to be punctured. Alright. If the voltage across the string were DC, katakanlah voltage adalah DC, the voltage across each unit would be the same. Kenapa? Kerana insulator capacitor tidak berfungsi untuk DC. Okay, alright. Kemudian kita akan belajar sikit tentang string efficiency. Okay, then uniform, the voltage applied across the string of suspension insulator is not uniformly distributed across various discs. So, the disc nearest to the conductor has much higher potential than the other disc. So, this unequal potential distribution is undesirable and is usually expressed in terms of string efficiency. So, formulanya adalah string efficiency equal to voltage across the string divided with N. Time voltage across this nearest to conductor. Voltage across this nearest to conductor kat sini lah, yang bawah ni eh. Okay. Voltage across the string dan dekat sini keseluruhan ni eh. Keseluruhan ni. N is the number of this. Berapa banyak this bergantung kepada jumlah eh, N tersebut. Okay, string efficiency is an important consideration since it decides the potential distribution along the string. The greater string efficiency, the more uniform is the voltage distribution. Oleh itu, 100% string efficiency is an ideal case for which the voltage across the each disc will be exactly the same. Kita nak 100% lah supaya voltage ni, okay, kalau kita tengok pada gambar ni, kita nak voltage dia sama je pada setiap disc. Eh. In term of mechanical expression, okay, kita tengok eh. Let us suppose that self-capacitance of each disc is C. Okay, self-capacitance ataupun mutual capacitance is C. Kita dah tengok tadi. Kemudian, assume that shunt capacitance C1 okay, is some fraction K of self-capacitance. Okay, sebahagian lah. Okay. C1 equal to KC. Okay. C1 equal to KC. Okay. Starting from the cross arm or tower, the voltage across each unit is V1, V2 and V3. Okay. Dalam gambar ni, yang ni cross arm eh. Yang ni cross arm, yang ni adalah conductor. Okay. So, kalau tengok gambar ni, pastikan yang atas adalah cross arm, yang bawah adalah conductor. Okay. Kemudian, kita apply Kirchhoff current law pada node A. Node A ni kita apply Kirchhoff current law. So kita akan dapati bahawa I2 sama dengan I1 plus I1. So I2 is here. This is I2 equal to I1 plus I1 eh, yang masuk ke dalam C1 ni. Oh, V2 omega C equal to V1 omega C plus V1 omega C1. Di mana C1 adalah KC. Dan kita dapat simplify the equation, we got V2 equal to V1, 1 minus K. So, kita dapat one equation lah. V2 equal to V1, 1 minus K. Okay. Now, we apply at node B. Apply at node B. Node B ialah I3 equal to I2 plus I2. So, this is I3 equal to I2 plus I2. Okay. So, V3 omega C equal to V2 omega C, okay, plus V1 plus V2 omega C1. C1 is equal to KC. Okay, so kita simplifikan equation dia, kita dapat V3 equal to V2 plus V1 plus V2K. Okay. And then we further simplify. Finally, we got V3 equal to 1 plus 3K plus K square. Okay. Now we have two equations. That is V1 equal to V1 1 plus K, and then V3 equal to 1 plus 3K. So V3 equal to V1 1 plus 3K plus K square. Okay, let's check the voltage between conductor and earth, that is tower. So V, okay, total, okay, total voltage from here, that is V, is equal to V1 plus V2 plus V3. Okay, so V1 is V1, V2 is V1 1 plus K, V3 is V1 1 plus 3K plus K square. So we got that V1 equal to, so V equal to V1 3 plus 4K plus K square. And we simplify, we got V equal to V1 1 plus K 3 plus K. Okay, now we have three equation. Okay, that is previously V2 equal to V1 1 plus K, V3 equal to V1 1 plus 3K plus K square. And then V equal to V1 1 plus K 3 plus K. So we simplify the equation, we got V1, okay, equal to V2 1 plus K equal to V3 divided with 1 plus 3K plus K square, and V divided with 1 plus K 3 plus K. So voltage on V1 is nothing but this equation. Okay, and voltage across second unit from top, V2 equal to V1 1 plus K, okay, V3 equal to V1 1 plus 3K plus K square. Alright, finally the string efficiency is nothing but voltage across string. Voltage across string is this one, V, okay, N is number of this. Of this we have 3, so 3 this here, and voltage across this nearest to conductor, that is V3. Okay, voltage across this nearest conductor, that is V3. Okay, if we have all this value, then we can calculate the string efficiency. So the method for improving string efficiency is, first we can use longer cross arm. Okay, efficiency depend on k, we see that C equal to KC. C1 equal to KC, KC. So K is the ratio of shunt capacitance to mutual capacitance. Okay, greater efficiency produce more uniform voltage distributed by using longer cross arm. Kalau pakai cross arm longer, lagi banyak lah, sebab kita akan kurangkan dia punya shunt capacitance. But limitation of cost and strength of tower do not allow the use of very long cross arm. In practice, K equal to 0.1 is the limit that can be achieved by this method. Alright. While solving problem relating to string efficiency, the following point must be kept in mind. First, the maximum voltage appear across the disc nearest to the conductor. Okay, kita dah terangkan tadi, maximum voltage appear kat sini lah. Disc nearest to the conductor. The voltage across the string is equal to phase voltage. Kat sini phase voltage. Okay, ini phase voltage. Line voltage ialah setiga time voltage across the string. Okay, so example 4.1. In 33 kV overhead line, there are 3 units in the string of insulator. Ada 3 lah, okay, sebab 1 tadi 11 kali 3, 33. So if the capacitance between each insulator pin and earth is 11% of self-capacitance of each insulator, find the distribution of voltage over 3 insulator and also the string efficiency. Dua benda nak cari Yang pertama, 33 kV. Okay. Yang kedua, ada 3 unit string. Kemudian 11% kapasiten, okay. Kemudian kita nak cari the distribution of voltage over three insulator. Nak cari V1, V2, V3 dan juga nak cari dia punya string efficiency, okay. So solution dia, so since kita ada tiga disk, so disk C, C dan C merujuk kepada tiga disk. So kita ada tiga self inductance ataupun tiga mutual inductance dan kita ada tiga shunt capacitance, okay, kat bahagian ni. Kemudian kita ada voltage across arm and conductor V. So dan voltage pada setiap disk, okay, start insulator V1, V2, V3, okay. So pertama kita kena draw equivalent circuit lah. Okay, ni equivalent circuit dia, okay. Yang kedua, calculate voltage across string. Yang ketiga, K equal to shunt capacitance bagi self capacitance. Okay, ratio dia. Yang terbaik ialah 0.1. Kemudian apply KCL at node A dan B. Apply A dan B. Sama je dalam kes yang sebelum ni. Okay, dan kita akan lihat voltage across this whole string. Okay, so V sama dengan V1 plus V2, V3. So V1 ni V1 lah, okay. V2 ni 1.11 ataupun 11% lebih daripada V1, okay. Manakala V3 ni adalah 1.342 V1. Maknanya dia adalah 1.342 ni adalah dia 1.11% lebih daripada V2 yang asal, eh. So kita dapat V equal to 3.452 V1 ataupun 19.5 sama dengan 3.45 V1 lah, ok. Dan kita akan dapat voltage across top unit V1 5.52. Kita kira voltage untuk V2 6.13, V3 dapat 7.4, ok. So kita kira string efficiency, voltage across string ni 19.5 ni, okay. Mana nak dapat? Cari sendiri, eh. Sama macam mana nak dapat? Dia ialah phase voltage kan? Okay. Now, number of insulator terhadap dengan V3. V3 adalah 7.4 ni. So, kita dapat string efficiency dia 85.8%. Okay. Jawapan pun dah diberikan di bawah ni, eh. You can make this exercise. Example 2, three phase transmission line is being supported by three disks, sama, three disk insulator. Okay, the potential across top unit near to the tower and middle unit are 8 kV and 11 kV. Okay, so dia bagi dah potential across top unit near to tower. So maknanya bahagian yang atas sekali, ada tiga bahagian, kan? Okay, bahagian yang atas sekali adalah 8, okay. Middle unit adalah 11. Middle adalah 11. Okay. Sekarang dia nak cari ratio of capacitance between pin and earth to the self capacitance of each unit. Okay, nak cari K lah. Okay, nak cari K. Kemudian cari line voltage dia dan cari dia punya string efficiency. Nak cari line voltage string efficiency, kita kena cari yang ni, eh, yang ni V kat sini. Okay. Okay, so jadi kita gunakanlah, okay, kaedah tadi. Okay, the ratio of capacitance between pin and earth to the capacitance of each unit, okay, okay. Line voltage dan juga string efficiency. So this is the solution. So you all boleh tengok the solution one by one, okay. So boleh buat belajar and try tulis-tulis sikit, dapatkan jawapan, eh, yang diberikan, okay. Now we look at the case of corona. Okay, what is corona? Corona is the phenomenon of violet glow, hissing noise and production of ozone gas in an overhead transmission line. Okay. Corona are caused when air, ground and energized conductor get ionized, causing a discharge. Okay, faktor-faktor yang menyebabkan corona adalah atmosphere, conductor size, spacing between conductor dan juga line voltage. Ada kelebihan corona. Due to corona formation, the air surrounding become conducting and virtual diameter of conductor is increased. Okay. Let's say this is conductor and this is corona. Okay. So look like that the diameter of inductor is increased. Eh? The increased diameter reduces the electrostatic stress between the conductor. Also, corona reduces the effect of transient produced by surge. Okay. However, there is the advantage of corona, that is, corona is accompanied by a loss of energy. This affects the transmission efficiency of the line. Okay. Energy loss, so efficiency reduced. Ozone is produced by corona and may cause corrosion of the conductor due to chemical action. Okay. Corrosion. Eh? The current drawn by the line due to corona is non-sinusoidal. Okay, non-sinusoidal. Eh? And hence, non-sinusoidal voltage drop occurs in the line. So this may cause interference with neighboring communication line. Okay. Method to reduce corona effect, first by increasing conductor size. Increasing conductor size, so the voltage at which corona occurs is raised and hence reduce the corona effect considerable. Second, by increasing conductor spacing, okay, increase the spacing, then the voltage increase the voltage at which corona to occur, hence reduce the corona effect. But increase too much will increase the cost of supporting structure. We need bigger cross arm and also much higher tower. Now we look at sag. Yeah. Kendur. Eh. Sag ni lebih kurang dalam saya kendur lah. Eh. Talian tu, overline yang kendur. Okay, kita lihat pada gambar rajah ni, sag can be defined as the difference in level between points of support and the lowest point on the conductor. So, katakanlah support dia kat sini ada tower A. Okay, yang ini ada tower B. So, di antara A dengan B, tengah-tengah ni adalah conductor. Purple ni conductor. So, berapa banyak dia kendur. Okay, dia panggil sag lah. Okay. Ataupun dalam gambar ni kita tengok, okay, seperti tadi dia ada dua tower. Okay, tower tower A, okay, dan juga tower B. Okay. Dan sag ni boleh berubah-ubah. Okay, bergantung pada cuaca. Eh. Sag on cold day. Pada sejuk, dia tak kendur sangat. Bila hot day, tengok eh, dia kendur sebab dia panas. Kan. Then there must be a minimum clearance lah. Antara sag tu minimum clean dengan objek di bawah dengan pokok ataupun dengan tanah eh. Okey, ni contoh yang diberikan lagi. Okey, ground clearance, okey, conductor, sag dan juga span. Okey. Dua kiri kanan ni adalah tower eh. Okay, sag in overhead line, while erecting an overhead line, it is very important that conductor are under safe tension. Tak boleh tegang sangat, kan? Tak boleh kendur sangat. Okay, if the conductor are too much stretched between support, the stress in the conductor may reach unsafe value and might cause conductor to break. Kalau tegang sangat pun dia boleh boleh putus kan? Boleh terputus lah, boleh pecah kan? Okay, in order to permit safe tension, the conductor are not fully stretched but are allowed to have a sag. The sag should be adjusted so that the tension in the conductor is within the safe limits. Okay. The tension is governed by conductor weight, effect of wind, ice loading, dan juga temperature variation. Okay. Kemudian, in standard practice, it is allowed always to keep conductor tension less than 50% of the ultimate tensile strength. The sag can be calculated based on two cases. Yang pertama, when support are equal level. Yang kedua, when support are not at equal level. So, we will see the example after this. Okay, let's say this is the calculation of sag when support are at equal level. Equal level means that the transmission tower are at the same height, the same height. So A and B, let's say this A and the B is at the same height. Okay, and then the span L divided with 2 in between. So the sag is at the middle. Okay, kenduran dia tu adalah seragam. Eh, dia tengah-tengah. So this is sag. Okay, kenduran dia. So this is Y, distance Y yang menunjukkan point P, manakala yang ni adalah X per 2. X ni adalah bahagian daripada kosong ke P. Okay. Dan T adalah tension of the conductor. So, formula untuk sag bagi keadaan equal adalah S equal to W L square bagi dengan 8 time T. Okay. Di mana S is adalah sag, L is the length of span. Length of span. Okay. Ini sag ni, S. W adalah weight per unit of conductor. T adalah tension of the conductor. T adalah tension of the conductor. Alright. Ataupun T equal to ultimate strength bagi dengan safety factor. Now example 4.3. 132 kilowatt transmission line has the following data. Weight 60 kilogram per kilometer. Length of span 260 meter. Okay, jarak antara dua tower 260 meter. Ultimate strength. Tension dia adalah 3100 kilogram. Safety factor dia adalah 2. Okay, calculate the height above ground at which the conductor should be supported. Okay, berapa tinggi di bawah tanah, okay, di bawah ground, okay, yang conductor boleh dipasang. And ground clear required is 10 meter. Okay. So we look at the solution. Weight of conductor per meter run, okay, W 680 over 1000, we got 0.68 kilogram. Okay. Working tension T, okay, ultimate strength divided with safety factor. So ultimate strength is 3100. Safety factor is 2, so we got T equal to 1550 kilogram. The span length is 260 meter. So directly we use all this value, put in the formula of sag. So we got the sag value is 3.7 meter. And then the conductor should be supported at the height of 10 plus 3.7 equal to 13.7 meter. Okay. Now we look at the calculation of sag when support are at unequal level. Okay. Bila ketinggian dia tak sama. Bagi contoh dekat bukit ataupun dekat sungai kan, kawasan-kawasan yang tidak rata. So in this case kita ada dua height. Yang pertama ada A, tower A dan juga tower B. Okay. Dan kita tengok dia yang sag pun ada dua. Yang pertama sag untuk tower A S1. Okay, sag untuk tower B S2. Okay. Dan juga kita ada H. H is the difference between tower A, tower B dengan tower A. Dan kita ada O adalah point of the sag, minimum point. Dan juga X1, X2 lah. Okay. X1, X2 ni adalah jarak antara O dengan tower A. X2 jarak antara O, antara tower B dan juga L adalah the length of span. So in this case for unequal level, so we can calculate sag using this formula. So S1, okay, for the case of this, S1 equal to weight time X1 square divided with 2T. Okay. Untuk sag yang kedua, S2 equal to weight X2 square divided with 2T. Di mana X1 plus X2 equal to L and X1 is L over 2 minus TH over WL, while X2 is L divided with 2 plus TH divided with WL. Okay, detail is here lah. L is length of span, H different in level between two support. Okay, H. X1 is strength of support at lower level A from 0. X2 distance B from 0. T is the tension of conductor. W is the weight per unit length of the conductor. So example 4.4, the tower of height 30 m and 90 m. So ada dua tower, iaitu 30 meter and 90 meter. Let's say tower A, tower B. respectively support a transmission line conductor at water crossing. The horizontal distance between the tower is 500 meter, quite long. Distance is 500 meter. The tension of conductor is 1600 kilogram. Okay, tension. Find the minimum clearance on the conductor and water, and clearance midway between the support. So kita nak cari minimum clearance of the conductor and water, okay, and clearance midway between the support. Weight of conductor is 1.5 kilogram per meter. Bases of the tower can be considered to be at water level. Okay. Now we look at the solution. Okay, this is the figure. Okay, ada dua tower A dan B. Span dia adalah 500 meter, 500 meter. Okay. So we know that L equal to X1 plus X2. X1 here. Okay. Plus X2 here equal to 500 meter. So we note it as a equation 1. Then diberikan weight equal 1.5 kilogram per meter. Also tension 600 kilogram. And the H is the difference between tower B dengan tower A ni. So kita dapat H adalah 90 minus 30 equal to 60 meter. Then kita calculate. Okay, sec untuk S1. Okay, kita ada formula tadi. Sec S1 guna formula yang ni. WX1 square bagi 2T. Okay. Sec untuk S2 adalah WX2 square bagi dengan 2T. Okay. So then, we can calculate H equal to S2 minus S1. Okay. Where S1 and S2 is given above tadi, or H already we have the number of H is 60. Okay, H is 60 equal to W divided with 2T times X2 plus X1, X2 minus X1. So we got the equation of X2 minus X1, X2 minus X1 equal to 256 meter. So we have another equation. Okay, first equation we have L equal to X1 plus X2 equal to 500 meter. Second equation X2 minus X1 256 meter. So from 1 and 2 we solve it. So we got X1 equal to 122 and X2 equal to 378 meter. All right. Then we can also calculate S1. Okay, which is using X1 from the calculation. So we got S1 equal to 7 meter. Then clearance of the lowest point O from water level must be 30 minus 7. So it will be 23 meter, right? Because S1 is 7 meter. Tower is 30 meter. Okay. So clearance is 23 meter. Is it okay or not? Then let the midpoint P be the distance X from the lowest point O. Okay. So then we can calculate X equal to 250 minus X1. So we got X equal to 128 meter. Okay. Then we can calculate the sec at midpoint. WX square divided with 2T, we got 7.68 meter. All right. So this is 122 meter X1, and then 378 meter for X2, 7 meter for sec S1, 23 meter is the clearance, 128 meter is the distance X between O and P, and the clearance of midpoint P from water level is 23 meter plus 7.6 equal to 30.68 meter. All right. Now we look at the mechanical principle of overhead line. Mechanical design of overhead transmission line must be, number one is tower height. Tower height depends on the length of the span. Okay, the longer the span, the higher the tower height. Okay, with long span, relatively few towers are required, but they must be tall and costly. it is not usually possible to determine the tower height and span lengths on the basis of direction of direct construction costs because the lightning hazards increase greatly as the height of the conductor is increased. Okay, longer span, which means that longer tower, okay, tower height will be increased, so lightning hazard also will be increased. Number two, conductor clearance to ground. So need to be considered. The conductor clearance to ground at the time of greater sag should not be less than some specified distance, usually between 6 and 12 meter. So if you look at back from the exercise before, is it allowable or not? Depending on the voltage, nature and local loss. Number three, sag and tension. The tension is governed by effect of wind, ice loading and temperature variation. So the relationship between tension and sag is dependent on the loading condition and temperature variation. Okay, for example, the tension increase when the temperature decrease and there is a corresponding decrease in the sag. Okay, so swinging charge is also important for the mechanical design. So for use in the field work of swinging the conductor, temperature sag and temperature tension charge. Okay, temperature tension charts are plotted for the given conductor and loading condition. This chart is very useful while stringing overhead lines. Okay, basically we will use this chart, okay, between tension and also the temperature. Conductor spacing, spacing of the conductor should be able to provide safely again flashover when the wires are swinging in the wind. Okay. The proper spacing is a function of span length, voltage and weather condition. Finally, conductor vibration, wind exert pressure. Wind exerts pressure on the exposed surface of the conductor. If the wind velocity is small, the swinging of conductor is harmless, provided the clearance is sufficient, sufficiently large so that conductor do not approach with the, within the sparking distance of each other. So that's all for our class in chapter 4 today.